God, we just thank you for letting us gather together today as your church, your people, your children, Father. We pray your protection and your blessing upon this service. Open our eyes and our ears and our hearts. And Father, give us strong voices to lift praises to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Won't you stand and join us and sing, Build Your Kingdom Here.
Come, set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come, set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come, invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in us.
Seek your kingdom first.
We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives for your joy and prize. To see the captives hearts released, the hurt is in the poor and peace. We inhale the lives for heaven's call. We are your church.
In this time of desperation, all we know is doubt and fear. There is only one foundation. We believe. We believe. In this broken generation, when all in dark you help us see, there is only one foundation. We believe.
Coming back again. We believe. got power.
My battery's down.
Oh, no. Hello, kids. Uh-oh. Am I still on? Okay. This mic drops once in a while. How is everybody? Everybody good? I know, yeah. All right. So, Pastor Carol Bookwalter is going to be talking about the body of Christ. Now, do you think she's actually going to talk about his physical body? So, what does it mean? What is the body of Christ? We got an idea, Derek? Don't embarrass me. What is it? Come on. What's the body of Christ? Okay. Someone who believes, yes. More. Reese. No. That's what the body of Christ should put on. Anything down here on the left? What is the body of Christ? Okay, well, good. Here we go then. All right, so this Lego set, we're going to compare and contrast how it's like the body of Christ. All right? The body of Christ is the church. It's the church. It's all of us made up together. All right, so my kids are only mildly fan of Legos. They're expensive. But I know, who loves Legos? Who loves? Okay, yeah. You're a big Lego fan. Okay, good. So I have nephews who are also huge Lego fans, and they have been their whole lives, and they put together pretty much on like Christmas Day their big gift of this ginormous Lego thing. All right, so when we first started Legos, we would lay them out, and we would get started, and then I'd get to a point, and I'd be like, oh no, we're missing a piece. And then I would remember the words of my sister, Lego never makes a mistake. And I'm like, oh no, but it has to be Lego's mistake. We couldn't have. And we were scared because we know without the even smallest little piece, I mean, it could be so random. Lego is so crazy. Like the smallest little weird hinge. And you're like, I'm not going to be able to finish this. This is not going to be complete because I'm missing one. And then thankfully we would look around and we'd find it and we'd say, you're right, Lego never makes a mistake. Here it is. And we would keep going. Okay, so Lego has all these little pieces and they are all important. But some you don't even see, right? Some are little, what might kind of seem insignificant, but they all have an important job, because without those little pieces, the big flashy pieces, the teeth or the headlights, the steering wheel, they all don't go together, right? They don't work. Okay, so let's think. How is this Lego putting together like the body of Christ? If each one of these Lego pieces represents you, me, the person sitting next to you, every single person who's a part of the church, Lauren, how are they like? Some dust? Okay, I like that. Okay, so yes, God is almost like that instruction manual, sure. He is what holds us together, so you are right about that. He does hold us together, but do you think there could also be people who work on the inside of the body of Christ also that are important? Yes. Okay, so we're all, go ahead, Charlotte. Okay, so God has given, just like these pieces in this Lego set, all different purposes. Some might seem really important and great and flashy, and others are behind the scenes important. They're good at planning. They are sensitive. They help feed the hungry person. They have a gift that God has given them that is different from another piece. See, if you have a gift, Hayden, that God has given you, and you don't show up to church, you're not in this box. We're not whole. We're not complete. We need every single person to come together as a body of Christ so we can complete His church. When we're missing one, we feel it. I mean, we could probably put it together, right, like a master builder and figure something out, but it wouldn't be quite the same. So God's given us all different purpose to come together for one purpose. And what's the one purpose? Yeah, to spread the word of Jesus, to be complete in him, yes, to further his kingdom. Okay, so we saw how we're alike. When we put Legos together, every piece is important. They're all different. You're all different. You're all important. God has given each one of you something different. Everyone in this church, something different. Not everyone gets up here and preaches, but there's important jobs, like the sound lady in the back, Leland in the back, the people up here on the stage singing, the people who plan things, our missions, they're all important. But you know how I think we're a little different? This is my problem with Legos, is once you put it together, what does it do? Sit on the counter. And you have to be careful because when you touch it, it actually all falls apart. There's not a lot you can do with it. But that's the opposite of the body of Christ. When we're together, working together, all using our gifts, we are the greatest force in the world because we have God in us. So we are the body of Christ, and God needs each one of us. All right, you ready? Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we love you so much. We thank you that you gave us the gift of church. You gave us togetherness where we lift each other up, make each other stronger, help these kids to know that they are so important in you. Help them to use their gifts to further your kingdom. We love you and we praise you. And all God's kids say.
Good morning. Do I need to push a button? I'm here. Before I didn't have batteries. Now I'm together. I invite you to pray with me. Gracious Lord, as we come together as the church, as a people of God, we invite your presence for you to fill the atmosphere and let us be in contact with you. Send your Holy Spirit. Because I'm only a vessel, and only you can bring the message. Anoint the words, anoint my thoughts, anoint our hearing, anoint our reception to you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. It's going to be different. Okay? You're going to think I'm a little wacko. I'm hoping, you already know that, right? For those of you who don't know me, I'm Carol Bookwalter, retired clergy, and I'm the visitation pastor for here at Trinity. And it's a delight because this is the church I went into ministry from, and so it's a delight to be back here again. I want to play around with some stuff, okay? And so I need your participation, and hopefully when we get to the end, it'll all come together like the body ought to, okay? Okay, let us begin. What is this? A square. What's it used for? Making right angles, measuring things. Right, okay. Next one. What's that? What's a planer do? A little bit off of time. Thank you. That's a good answer. Okay. Next one. What's that used for? Measuring. So what's the difference between the square and the tape measure? Different purposes, right? One can you measure with it, but it's getting your square together. And the other, you can measure long distances, right? Depending on the length of your tape measure, right? Next one. A handsaw, okay? What's it do? How many have used one? Come on, ladies. Oh, come on. We got to get some. I've done that. Okay. What's the next one? It's a keyhole saw. Yeah, we're going to get that one later, okay? What's it used for? Yeah. It does that little kind of deal there. Get things started, and sometimes you're real skilled, you can even do small circle type things with it. So it's called a keyhole saw. Both are saws, right? But a different purpose, okay? Next one. What do we use it for? Yeah, I'm letting your camper sit level. How about leveling your stove so all the cakes don't go this way? Oh, what do you use it for? Yes. Construction, yes. Okay, next one. Most of us know what that is. What do you use with do it for here? What does it use for? Where it needs a nail, that's right. The big thing is it's a nail. Okay, next one. How many women knew what that was? Oh, good, oh, good. What's it used for? Ultimately, yeah. The center of gravity, yeah. Okay. True vertical level. True vertical level, okay? So there's a relationship between the level and the plumb line, right? Because the level can do flat surfaces too. A plumb line can only do vertical, but they make for the levelness or the evenness or straightness. Next one. What does a stapler do? Hold things together. Women like to use that sometimes, okay? Do you ever watch women putting up posters in places and buildings? Yeah, it's a matter of recognizing that it's a something that does attach things. So there's a similarity between a stapler and a hammer. One uses nails and some big nails. Staplers sometimes use a little nail, depends on the type of stapler thing. But it's using an attack of type thing to hold things together, okay? What's next? What's the hand look like? I just had to put this one in. Kind of looks like a Jesus sleeve, right? And his word is our plumb line. Just to throw in. Next slide. What's this? Yeah, it's a key square. And it still does what? You can actually do a 45 angle or a right angle. But this one also has a little minor level thing on it. Okay? So it kind of ties in with the other levels, doesn't it? Okay, what's next? What's a coping saw that used for? Very fine cuts. They can make those little things for dollhouses and all kinds of stuff. So now we've seen three different types of saws, right? Keep that in mind, right? Okay, what's next? What's a chisel do? It's kind of like the planer, isn't it? Does a little bit at a time, hopefully. What's next? What are they? Pardon? Lathe tools, yes. It's a special type of carving. Again, it's a type of chisel, but you'll notice that each one of them has a different type of... I'm going to take this off. I'm sorry. It's bugging me. Bugging you too, huh? But they make different cuts, okay? Next, this one is a generational one. What's that? Hand drill. The kind my dad uses, right? Next one. A little more type of drill, right? And then? Manpower, right? Okay. They all do the same thing, but they look different, right? Okay. Next. A garden rake, used in the garden, right? Sometimes I get upset and I use it in the yard, but it helps thatch, right? That's my excuse. What's next? A leaf rake, okay? Difference? Pardon? Yeah, they're different. In what way? Their purpose, what they're used for is different, okay? Next. So, yeah, either way, does the same thing, right? They do both, right? What's next? What's that for? Mostly in the garden, right? Okay, next. Oh, yes, we like that when we get fences put up, right? So the common thing in all these is they're outdoor toys that are primarily used in dirt of some form or in the garden, okay? Recognizing that. What's next? This is my favorite one. Oh, what? Keaton. Yeah, okay. What's next? It's getting cold enough for it, right? We're getting there, okay? What's this? What do they usually call it? Square blade or flat blade, okay? Next one. Oh, grain shovel. We call it a coal shovel. I know, it's dating me. My grandparents, until I don't know how, maybe they still have a coal furnace in that house. I don't know. But yes. Four different shovels, all with a different use or purpose, right? Okay, ladies, we haven't left you out. What's next? What's a wooden spoon used for? It's used on the proper place of the body, right? What is it used for? Stirring, right? Mixing things up. What's next? What's that do? Mashed potatoes, mixing them up, right? What's next? What's it used for? Mixing ingredients, right? Yep, used for? Mixing ingredients. Next. Five different instruments. All the purpose is common. Okay? Yeah, mixing ingredients. Next. How many women still use them? So many, okay, good. I'm surprised how many do that. Actually, like my grandmother, just pensioned it. But anyhow. Next. How many men use this? Yeah, most of them. Okay. What's next? What's it used for? Cookie dough, right? Pie dough. Okay, next. Biscuit cutter, or some of them are used for chopping vegetables. Next. Yeah, food processor. Chops up stuff. So what do they have in common? They manipulate what? Food, right? It's all used in food preparation. Okay, completely different things, but the object is still the same thing. Next. What type of spoon? Sliding spoon, and what do you use it for? Yeah, getting out of that. What's next? Slaughter spoon. It still does the same thing. The one you usually use in bigger pots, and the other one usually more, this one is more like a pot one, but we also have them in tablespoons. What's next? Whatever. It's a pie server, right? I think it's proper name. What's next? A spatula. What do they have in common? Scooping food out and put them on a serving thing, all right? Okay. What's next? Go along the same category. Spaghetti thing, yeah. What's next? What kind of fork? Pardon? A meat fork, right? What's next? Okay, now what do they all do? They serve foods, right? In certain ways, okay? Next. What's it used for? Primarily bread, yeah. What's next? No, it's not. It's actually a table knife. I know, it's small. I was getting them on a plate, okay? Then what? What's the difference between a table knife and a steak knife? One sharp and does meats and stuff, and the other good for buttering things or putting jelly or whatever on. What's next? Carving knife, yes. Next one? A chef's knife. Last one? Filet knife, okay? They're all knives, right? Right? What are their purposes? They all cut, but they are very varied in their purpose, okay? Next slide. Now, what do you kind of gather from this? If we're talking about becoming the body of Christ, why would I show all these tools and instruments? Oh, you want an interesting thing? When I was looking this up, utensils are things that are used in kitchens or food preparation are actually tools. But they have a separate category called utensils. But the things that were all the hammers and saws and all that are just tools. So utensils go in with it. So when your ladies talk about men say you don't know how to use tools, say, beg your pardon, my tools are in my kitchen, correct? I want to look at what we've just done. So just kind of keep it in mind. And part of it has to do that you may have something called knives. And they serve a similar purpose, but they look and do something differently. But they're still called knives. Or we can look at those things like yard tools with the different rakes and the shovels and the trimmers and the edgers and stuff, the pole diggers. They are way different, but their purpose is still the one thing. Okay? So I want to look at that as we look at the scripture from 1 Corinthians. Okay. This is Paul's chapter about the gifts and stuff, okay? Beginning at verse 4. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministry, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. Now, I want to notice there, what three things did you see listed? Okay, gifts, ministries, activities. What else three different did you see? Same spirit, same God. Okay? Paul puts in the Trinity in this place when he's talking about the gifts and the ministries of the church. It's the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit all are active in that. Okay? Okay? And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation, some translations will say the gifts. Now, my understanding from the Greek is what we often call the gifts of the Holy Spirit are the manifestations. They are the exhibitions exhibiting the Spirit that's within us. That the gift that God gives us is the Holy Spirit. When we ask Christ to come in our heart, the Holy Spirit comes. And when we ask to be used by God, you know, we're basically saying, Lord, let that Spirit give me the gifts and abilities that I need to perform in a body, okay? And so it talks about here, the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one, okay, for the, what's it, of, okay? Some will say common. It's a matter of recognizing, as I thought she was talking about, you know, the way we're each different. But each one of us have been given a gift. Some may be more than one gift. But those gifts are given to you by the Holy Spirit, and it's not for your benefit. I've seen people, I've gone to services, and they'll say, I've got a word from the Lord. And they may have a word from the Lord. But once they say, I have, they're out of order. Because the word is coming from God. You may say there's a word from the God for you, or there's a word from the Holy Spirit, okay? And a matter of recognizing that it's from the Spirit, and everyone has gifts, and we're going to see this in a few moments. And the gifts that we have are for all of the body. It's kind of interesting because it's best to be using gifts in the body of Christ. Do you know why? It's a tricky thing, okay? First of all, the people that are in the body have the Spirit within them, so working with spiritual gifts brings about greater fold, okay? And we'll see later on that the gifts are used to equip the church. It's a matter of preparing it and making it a healthy body to function. And if people outside the church see the people in the church seeing these things happen and seeing lives change, what's it going to do to the people on the outside? It's intrigue them. It'll draw them in, and they get to know Christ. As the body is transformed, it becomes a magnet. Now, that doesn't eliminate gifts that we need to go out with, okay? But I want to say, as the church becomes the body of Christ in action, it becomes a drawing point to people outside. If you read the book of Acts, you see all these people being changed, and it drew people in, and the church drew by hundreds and thousands. It's just kind of an interesting process that goes on, okay? Okay, for one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, another is given a word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another by the faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, and to another interpretation of tongue. But one and the same Spirit work all these things, distributing each one individually as He wills. I was guilty when I became aware of the Holy Spirit and saying, I know what I don't want. Okay? And it's just one of those things, you know, you don't want to deal with this, you don't want to deal with that. But sometimes the thing you don't want is the thing God wants you to have, and then sometimes it's a war as I had with God, but He won. So it's a matter of recognizing God has each one of us uniquely made. It talks about that in Psalm 139. We are uniquely made, and we are made for particular use of certain gifts or skills or talents in the body of Christ. It's what Paul's telling us here, okay? It just goes on. I'm going to skip down to verse 27, okay? Now you are the body of Christ and members individually, okay? Recognizing it. Paul talks in between there about how the foot says I'm not part of the body because I'm a foot, and, you know, and so forth. But it's a matter of recognizing that that doesn't work, and that's what Paul's getting around. He's used a little irony there. Okay, meet my new friend. Isn't he cute? I call him the marshmallow person. I decided to use him for illustrations. Next slide. Okay? Next. God gives us everything we need. Do you think you have everything you need? Don't raise your hands. Okay? It's a matter that often we feel we're lacking in certain things. But I want to share some things that has been written in Scripture about what God has given us. Next slide. We are together the body of Christ. Remember, this is the whole thing. Next one. These are skills, and I'm not going to read the Scriptures all. These are the skills that are listed when Moses was getting the tabernacle together in the wilderness. And it says, and God gave to some skills or abilities, usually, okay, to work in gold or silver or bronze, okay? They could make lampstands and basins and candelabras and all kinds of things, okay? They could make utensils. They could cut stone, set it. They could work in wood. They could do all kinds of crafts. They made all the furnishings, the ark and all the angels and the stands and the bread holders and all that for the tent. They made the altar for the incense on. They made the incense. They made the oils. They wove the cloth. They even took the goat's hair and women. That's one of the things they were given the ability to, was to mold it together and make it red and blue and purple threads. These are all things that were necessary for the building of the tabernacle. Do you think we need some of this stuff today? Right? Ask the trustees. Ask the sewers in the quilt club, okay? Ask the Sunday school teachers, especially when it comes to vacation Bible school time, okay? The same skills and talents are needed today. Do you think God stopped doing that? I don't think so. Next. Now, these are the gifts that come. First one. We just read about it, okay? The wisdom, the faith, the knowledge, the healing, miracles, tongues, interpretations, discernment. Those were the gifts that are listed in Paul's letter to the Corinthians. But if you go to Ephesians 4, he lists some ministries. He says he gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, and some teachers. Different categories. And that's one of the reasons I wanted to point out the fact when we talk about things being like, you have an evangelist. Some of them will be like the knife, the butter knife, and do things nice and gentle. Other may be like the carving knife and go, shoo, okay? You have different ways in which different people function in different gifts. The same thing with pastors. Some are, one of the things I learned, let's go with teaching. One of the things I learned early on in my Christian walk was there were some teachers like better than others. None of you don't do that with your Sunday school teachers, but we have a favorite type. And it took me a while to figure out the ones I liked were the inspirational ones that just got you all hyped up. And what the others were called, I learned to call them, is doctrinal teachers. They talked you the bread and butter steps. They took you from the bread and got you the potatoes and got you up to the vegetables and to the meat. They were progressing you in learning the things and principles of God. I like the ones that got me more excited. So anyhow, so there were different ways. And then Paul, in the chapter 12 of Romans, you find, he says, and God has dealt each of us a measure of faith. Now, I want my faith to grow. Do anybody of you want your faith to grow? Oh, my, this is my big prayer, okay. But God has given each one of us a measure of faith. A measure, could be a little bit, a lot. But the thing is, it tells faith grows by hearing the word of God. So it's something that you exercise. There's a gift of faith which is different, but everyone has this ability. Okay, some members have different functions, okay? Some have gifts according to the grace given. One, prophecy, let them prophesy in proportion to their faith. In ministry, which is helping others in that. In teaching, exhorting, gives. There's those who have a gift of getting money. They're supposed to give liberally, okay? And those who worked with diligence to show mercy and cheerfulness. So Paul has different places, has different things in which he gives us that are part of the ministry of the body of Christ. And each one of us has at least one gift if you believe in Jesus Christ. You with me? So if somebody says, do you have a gift? Don't say, I don't think so. I don't know of it. Start searching for it. Start looking for it, asking God to show you. Now, we're talked about, and I love the Lego thing. I'm glad she did it with the building type thing because I'm doing it with these little marshmallow people, okay? Each one of us has a purpose. And if one is missing, the body's not whole, okay? Slide. What do you see? A lot of marshmallow people. What else do you see? There's a missing. Is there just one missing? How many? See three? Pop slide. Another slide. Another. There are three missing. Okay? And I put them in the shadows. I was having fun playing, as you can tell. I like to play with Legos, too. I put them in the shadows because often what happens in the body, a part that's needed, we let them drift away. And we don't go and get them back. So somebody in the body has the job of being the shepherd dog. Okay? To help bring it around and making whole. Because we need the body to be whole. Next slide. Soliciting of volunteers. Have you ever heard of anything about that? Huh? What kind of volunteer things have we heard here at church recently? Feathers. Do you see how many feathers are left? They're putting them together Wednesday, I think it is. Okay. Now, we put it all together, or somebody put it together, which actually lets you have a better picture of how many still need to be filled. Not that I'm badgering you, but maybe I am. There's another thing. We have Advent starting in 2 weeks. I looked at the chart before I came in. There's only one name, and you got to realize we have 4 Sundays of Advent with 2 services. It means 8 people plus Christmas Eve. We need people to sign up. It's out there. And next Sunday night, we're having a choirs here. There'll be the Tabernacle Choir joined with the Trinity Choir, plus hopefully a lot of you here. And we're going to do pies as a social to allow a little socialization to take place between the two churches. How many have signed up to bring a pie? That's right, none. Okay. My suggestion is if you don't want to bake a pie, is let Jane Lender know you'll pay for one. Okay. She's overseeing that. I know. Okay. But again, it's a matter of recognizing the body of Christ. And I know we've got some good cooks in here, and I know some specialize in pies and stuff, but we shouldn't always have to depend on the same ones. It's a matter of recognizing we're a body, and this is a way of developing gifts and recognizing that. But any of you ever use any of those excuses when somebody came to ask you to do a job? I have. I know I can't do it as well as so-and-so. I can't do that. Oh, that's a job for so-and-so. We have a tendency to do that. I want to share just a moment. I guess I should watch the time clock. We're okay. One of the things that I discovered, and it took me a while to get through my hard head, is somebody would ask me to do something, and I said, I can't do that. And sometimes what that person was doing was providing me an opportunity to explore ministries I liked or didn't like. I'll never forget, the first time it happened, by this time I had my third child was a baby, and we went to this little small church south of San Diego, right 3 miles from the border in Mexico. And we were there for a little while, and this lady came up, and I started singing in the choir. And one night she came up, she says, Carol, I want you to start a children's choir. Me? I've never done anything like that. I was very quick about it. And she says, you can do it. You can read the music. I said, I can't do that. I can't play the piano. She says, I've already got a pianist for you. Hello. Guess who started the children's choir? Well, I didn't feel so bad about that in a little church then. It went okay. Kids had fun. We moved from the West Coast to the East Coast to Delaware, and we ended up in this large Methodist church. And there was no adult Sunday school. The Sunday we arrived, one other couple arrived wanting to Sunday school for adults too. So the four of us started one, and we grew a class. But lo and behold, the pastor called me. It wasn't like here. I really didn't know the pastor. Large enough church, insignificant. Called me and says, understand you do children's choirs. How do you know? The pastor sent him a letter. I never saw that of the pastor begin. But it was interesting. So in this large church, I'm doing these little silly children's songs in this very formal church. But anyhow, I started another one, and they found me a pianist. I used the same excuse. But it's a matter of recognizing I could do that, but that was not my comfort zone. That is not where I felt most comfortable. And I started teaching Sunday school, and that I found much more my place. It's a matter sometimes when you're asked, it's okay to do it and say, oh, this isn't for me. Give me something else to do. And you begin to explore and discover different ways to do ministry. Next slide. Ministry to shut-ins and the lonely is one of the greatest needs I see in the church. Okay? I don't know about you. My grandchildren and my children are my tech people. Because as you get older, this technology stuff, and you can't get one of them little old-fashioned phones anymore. So one of the ministries is to help older adults in different ways. And one of the ways also, next slide, is a matter of recognizing visitation. Now, I'm glad to be a part of a community here where family cares about family. And a lot of people that live alone or are older are seeing their family on a regular basis, and they'll brag on you when I go to visit. But it's interesting, they'll talk about so-and-so came to visit, and it's somebody that's not a family member. And it becomes a very special emphasis. Why? Because somebody outside the family cared enough about me to take time to come. It becomes a very special thing when somebody that isn't family shows up. Not to minimize the family, but it says something. Now, I want to share something. You don't have to be a brilliant person to go visit. I call it the ministry of presence. Not gifts, you know, not with bows on. It's your very presence there. Because Christ is in you, when you go to see somebody, you take Christ there too. And it's interesting because they'll say, I feel so much better since you're here. It's that presence of Christ in you that helps fill that place, and it makes a difference. And so you don't have to have great discussions. You don't have to have quoted Bible verses. It's just a matter of sitting down or standing by the bedside and saying a few kind words to them. The ministry of presence is a powerful, powerful thing. Next. I missed one. The other one is about, the ladies do this fairly often, is go and have lunch together. And I was up in Bethlehem at a small church, and I found out there was a group of men that met every morning for breakfast at Hardee's. It's a way in which socialization takes place, and they're part of a unit, and it's an important thing. Okay? Next. The ministry to the weak, the elderly, and the needy. And I see this more for men, but there's jobs in this for women that we need to recognize. There's a lot of little handiwork that need to be done around homes, okay? Repair work, things that people can do. Next one. Garden work, yard work. Elderly can't get out and do that type of work, and so helping hands makes a big difference. Next one. Caulking, working on things. Another one, plumbing. Now, it's one of those things that's great because if you have that skill gift, this may be one of the things that you do as part of the body of the Christ, right? Is doing maintenance type things. Women are good at them too. Women make good painters and things like that. But it's a matter of recognizing that's done. One of the things is older people are a little bit skeptical about these companies you call and they come in. They have a trust issue. But if somebody comes from their church, it makes a difference. So it's helping, okay? Next one. Ministry possibility. We've got ministries in this church, but there's more, okay? That I think could be. Let's look at some of the ones we've got or could have. Now, I put this one on for Butch and Curtis, okay? Because every time we have something done that needs tables and chairs, guess who does it? Yeah. Butch and Curtis primarily. What if there was a team that came alongside to assist? Okay. I always forget their name. Okay. Exchange Club met here yesterday. And the lady, apparently they came up and set up for themselves. And she said, it's amazing. It takes an hour to set up and 15 minutes to break down because everybody's left helps take down. And it's a good thing. But setting up sometimes is an interesting part of ministry. And different folks can, if they know something, someone is call and say, can I give you a helping hand? What that does for ministry, okay? It's a matter of seeing these other parts of understanding. Next. Praise band. I know this is an odd looking one. I thought it was a funny praise band. Members, next one. Teaching small children. Next. Choirs. Next, nursery, all places that people can volunteer. Now, I'm going to spot one that's not on this list, is parking lot greeters. I visited Rick Warren's church out in California. Their parking lot's miles long, but anyhow, in every part of the parking lot, they had greeters to greet you before, when we got out of your car. And you went up the walk, before you get to the steps of the church, they had a greeter there, plus at the door. It was amazing to think about that, okay? Next slide. There are positions for God-given gifts. That's what we are, God-given gifts to people, okay? First one is the greeters. Next, what are we going to be doing? Fixing food for things to help people who are poor or maybe be doing without. Next. Praying in the sanctuary, okay? We'll get back to that in a second. Next. How about tutoring children? Parents work long hours, after-school program, help with the children. Next, prayer circles. We have one on Wednesday mornings. What do we need other ones? That's one of those things that I have done a lot of things in ministry, is develop different types of prayer ministry, like ones who come in and pray through the sanctuary every Sunday morning. Somebody that comes and prays through all the classrooms during the week before church on Sunday. People who pray for the people who are going to come into the place. Praying for healing, praying intercessions. There's all kinds of matters in recognizing that. Okay? It's just back to the body. I want to recognize, if we have a choir, what parts are there? Sopranos? What? Altos? Tenors? Bass? Okay? They're all people, but they come together and makes a joyful sound. There are all kinds of instruments. They come together. It's a matter that all this takes place as the body of Christ. Different gifts, different instruments, different voice ranges, different activities, different ministry, different gifts. You get in the picture? And they come together and they make the body, right? Next one. Where's the body? Okay. This body just a skeleton. It's got a Christian. It's got a heart, right? For Christ. Next. What if this has to do with skills with wood? Another. How about fixing the altar? Another one. How about the one who works on church furniture or church settings for vacation Bible school? Next. Evangelism. Prophecy. How about nursery, small children? How about youth workers? How about the worship team? Or greeters, ushers? How about the gift of wisdom? How about pastors? Miracles, healing, finance. Got my picture? It's a matter that the body is made up of many parts. Just like you have a heart and a gallbladder and a stomach and pancreas and lungs and intestines and bladder and kidneys. You know, we have these many parts, but they all become one body and they are essential. Okay? Each one does their part. There's a place for everyone. Now, in wrapping this up, I told somebody God gave me a different ending. It's a matter of recognizing it's one thing to know this with your head. Okay? It's another thing to allow the mind and the heart to communicate together before God. Pastor Tricia just did a sermon, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, right? Now I want to emphasize the heart and the mind, because we can learn things and we can be robots and do things, but if it's going to be the body of Christ, it takes the Holy Spirit to bind us together. You following me? And so it's a matter of recognizing that we need to understand that we need to discover what our gift is. And the way to do that is before God. It's a matter of praying and saying, Lord, yes, I accept you as my Savior. I want to be part of the body. Let your Spirit use me. Show me what it is that is my gift. What is it that I get excited about? What is it that maybe cost me strength, but I'm excited when I'm finished saying, that was good, that was good? It's a matter of discovering that God has uniquely made you, designed your personality and your whole being for specific things he wants to do with you. It's in the Word. Go look at Ephesians 2:10. You're God's workmanship, made in Christ Jesus for good works. And it goes on to say that God planned them before you were even born. And so sometimes in church we sit and say, but I don't know what mine is. I don't know what mine is. What is it that gets you excited in church? And if you haven't found it, try something else. One of the guilty things of church is if you're a school teacher, they think you're a Christian teacher. Some are. Most aren't. Some have been blessed to be teaching in the same thing where they're spiritually gifted. But a lot of people, one of the best teachers I had was an Air Force pilot. Okay? Another one was an electrical engineer. Hello? It's a matter of recognizing. And I actually had a plumber who taught youth and did a great job. It's a matter of recognizing God has a gift for you, and that gift is needed for this body to be complete. He comes with knowing Jesus as your Savior and letting Him be Lord in your spirit, alive with His Spirit, so that you can learn to know and sense in your mind, in your heart, yes, I need to do that. This is my calling. There are certain things we're all called to do. We're all called to be witnesses. We're all called to pray for people. We're all called to be loving and kind to people. There are things that are universal for all of us. But those are those unique things, those special skill gifts, the special talents that work with wood and things and works with people, works in the kitchen. There's all kinds of those things. And then there's those things that have to do with teaching and pastoral care. It's interesting, we make too much emphasis, but the pastor, that's the one that's spiritually gifted. Yeah, I'm gifted by God for this role. But the praise band's gifts are just as important, and the ones who pass out the bulletins are just as important. The tech team is too. The ones who help clean up after Sunday school are just as important. No person is unimportant in the God and kingdom. Next Sunday, we're going to talk a little bit about God loves you. He can't stop loving you. But His grace and His blessings become more abundant as we walk in the way He planned for us to be. Whether it's getting feathers or singing or being that person that's in church that sees somebody that needs a touch and you speak to them and say, "Missed you, glad you're here." Do you know what that means to somebody that's been away? It's a matter of knowing you are gifted. Now, if I ask somebody right now in this room, do you have a gift from God? What are you going to do? Okay. If I ask that, can you say, yes, I know I have a gift? You don't have to know what it is yet. Do you know that God has given you a gift? It's a matter of recognizing that. Because that's the beginning of acknowledging God loves you and works within you. You are. Collectively, we are the body of Christ. May each of us do our part. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we come in Jesus' name, asking that You would touch us with a willingness to explore and discover what it is You've created us to be. Help us to acknowledge that. Help us to know that You love us enough to give us that. Give us the willingness to step out and trust You will lead. And sometimes people will ask us different things to help us along the way and get the experience of things we can do and things that aren't ours. But Lord, let the body become the body of Christ. Guide us by Your Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen. I've kind of snuck in a couple things, but we're going to reinforce there are some announcements. Okay, what's one of them? Thank you, Samantha. Okay. Pies, feathers, Advent wreath. Okay? Sign-ups, please, please, please. It's a matter of recognizing and bringing the body together, okay? Nursery volunteers are needed for time slots. Maddie will be glad to help you with that. Choir is still working on the cantata that's going to be combined with Tabernacles Choir, and that's going to be awesome. You're excited, yes. They're talking about it already amongst themselves and sharing it, so... still for a few voices, but come soon, okay? Thursday morning Bible study at 9:30. Still open.
Still open.
Okay.
We're still celebrating Advent, getting ready to.
Okay, very good. Yes, they've got a good study coming on. I read that one of the books of that, okay? Wednesday night, men's Bible study, ladies' Bible study on Wednesday night. We've got a prayer thing on Wednesday mornings. It's not on here. The 20th of November is the Thanksgiving community service here at 7 o'clock. That's where we need the pies for. But it's one of those things. One of the Thanksgiving services I went to, the church that was hosting had hardly anybody there. Please, your presence is a blessing to the people who come, okay? And the Advent lighting. Anything else?
Just one thing I want to add. Cindy wanted everyone to know that if you take a feather today, that the deadline for bringing food in is Wednesday. And if your gift is giving money towards that, they will be shopping after that to complete anything that's not already done. But if you do take one, if you could get it back to church by Wednesday.
Thank you. How many have needs for prayer or know people need prayer needs? Okay, let us go to the Lord. Gracious Lord, by the power of your Spirit, we thank you for being here. And we extend your Spirit, Lord, to those who need prayer that are in our community, for those that are having procedures, those who are transitioning from this world to the kingdom world, for those who are in hospitals, those who are in nursing homes. We pray for those who are sick, those who are having social issues with relationships, financial issues, home issues. Lord, you know what the needs are for our government, for us. Thank you, Lord, that you know them and you can hear them and touch them from your riches and glory. Help us, Lord, as the people of God, to pray as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to stand for our closing praise. the message. You are made, I am made more than thrive. We are moving on, prospering, growing, alive. Find your gift and find the excitement in Christ. Be the people of God who make the body of Christ. Go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And God's people said, amen. God bless you. Have a good week. A little chillier, but it's good.